The author then says, وَتَرْجِعُ الْأَحْكَامُ لِلْيَقِينِ فَلَا يُزِّيلُ الشَّكُّ لِلْيَقِينِ The author, he said that. رحمه الله. He says, وَتَرْجِعُ الْأَحْكَامُ لِلْيَقِينِ فَلَا يُزِّيلُ الشَّكَّ لِلْيَقِينِ This place, the author, رحمه الله تعالى, he is saying, وَتَرْجِعُ الْأَحْكَامُ لِلْيَقِينِ That the Sharia, it goes, it comes, and it revolves around certainty. That's what it revolves around. The word yaqeen in the Arabic language, it means zawalu shakki, it's the removal of doubt. Some of the usuliyin, they say, inna al-yaqeena fi lughati ma'khudhun min al-istiqrar. Some of the usuliyin, they say that yaqeen, it means istiqrar, when a matter settles itself. Yuqalu, they say, yaqana al-ma'u, the water is still. بمعنى استقر and the ones who said that is Ibn Taymiyyah and Al-Hamawiyyah Yaqut Al-Hamawi, he said that and Ibn Taymiyyah said that technically the word yaqeen means what? طُمَأْنِينَةُ الْقَلْبِ وَاسْتِقْرَارُ الْعِلْمِ فِيهِ it means that your heart finds tranquility and it also finds what? It settles on knowledge in this matter You, in your heart, you feel like, mashallah, there is knowledge regarding this issue. The opposite to yaqeen, the author mentions it, is shak, doubt. And doubt is what? Yuradu bihi tadakhulu. What does it mean? At-tadakhul is when things enters onto each other. What entered into each other? Matters are all mixed up. You don't know which one is which. وَذَلِكَ لِأَنَّ الشَّاكُ يَتَدَاخَلُ عِنْدَهُ أَمْرَانِ لَا يَسْتَطِعُ تَرْجِيحُ بَيْنَهُمَا Two matters enter onto each other, and he doesn't know how to distinguish them from one another or separate them from one another or differentiate one another from each other, from one another. He doesn't know. The word shak, technically it means tajweezu amrayni fama zada wala maziyata li ahadihima ala sa'iriha. It is permitting to. Both of them are acceptable to you. None of them has as an additional power over the other for you. Not one of them do you have an inclination towards over the other. That's called doubt. Both of them are a possibility to you. Now, when the author says, وَتَرْجِعُ الْأَحْكَامُ لِلْيَقِينِ that the Sharia and the Ahkam of the Sharia goes back to what? It goes back to certainty. Here it may seem like, and it might be to some people, that the author is trying to say that the religion doesn't base ruling on dhannul ghalib, assumption which is very high, and the author doesn't mean that. وَلَيْسَ مُرَادُ الْمُؤَلِّفِ That's not the intent that the author wants. Rather, the author sees that it is permissible, rahimahullah, that إِعْمَالُ dhannul ghalib, that we work on high assumptions. And the ahkam of the Sharia, it does come to work on high assumptions. You see, in many matters. And the evidence for that is in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 230. Allah says, فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ مِنْ بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا أَن يَتَرَاجَعَ إِن ظَنَّا أَن يُقِيمَ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ So Allah says, if a man divorces his wife, فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا the man divorces his wife, فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ It is not permissible for him مِنْ بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ It is a man who divorced his wife طَلَاق بَائِن He fully let his wife go. He finished all of his divorces on her. She's gone through what? بَيْنُونَةِ الْكُبْرَى Finished it all. What does she have to go through? Another man has to get married to her. You see? Now, فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا If the other man she got married to then divorces her, But then that divorce has to not stip, it can't be an idea or a plan set by the wife and the husband, like go get married to another wife, a husband, and then come back to me. No. That marriage is not considered a permissible marriage. If they two go together, that man and the woman, and they go together, then that is not considered as what? Even marriage, they're committing zina, both of them. And the man can't even come back to his wife again because she didn't even get married. So, there is no permissibility in that. But it means that the wife, in a genuine way, what does she do? She goes and gets married to another man. And she just doesn't want to be with that man anymore. She doesn't want to be with him. And remember, the condition is that حَتَّى يَذُوقَ عُسَيْلَتَهَا وَيَذُوقُ عُسَيْلَتَهَا. They have to have a relationship with one another. Intimacy has to occur. But if the woman has in her brain, and she goes to her husband and says, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to get married to this man and I will deliberately leave him for you. If she says that and she comes to him and he gets married to her, is that permissible? Yes, it's permissible. And that marriage is sah. There's nothing wrong. If she came with the idea and he did not input anything towards it, if he didn't say to her, do it, if he didn't, ha. But with the condition, she has to go through intimacy and relationship with what? She has to go through relationship with the other man. Naam. فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا. If then her and that man go separate ways, Allah says, فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا. There is no harm on both of them, أَن يَتَرَاجَعَ, to come back to each other. But Allah says something, إِن ظَنَّا. If they both have what? High assumption, أَن يُقِيمَ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ, that they will both fulfill Allah's boundaries and limits, that they will both fulfill each other's responsibilities, that they will not go against Allah's religion, that they both will. So, where did Allah condition this ruling of permissibility on? فَلَا جُنَاحَ. It is no harm, no problem if they do that. But with when? إِن ظَنَّا. So what we say is, فَعَوَّلَ بِالْحُكْمِ عَلَى الظَّنِّ. The dhan is what's being made the ruling on here right now. Good. And the dhan here means what? Dhan means الْإِحْتِمَالُ الرَّاجِحُ. We took it in Sool al-Fiqh. It's ihtimal al-rajih. It's the two views, you have the stronger one. 60%, 70%, you believe it. And also the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he himself, he did the same. In the authentic hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَا أَظُنُّ, I do not think, أَنَّ فُلَانًا وَفُلَانًا, I don't think so and so, يَعْرِفَانِ مِن دِينِنَا شَيْئًا, I don't think so and so, have any knowledge of our religion. The Prophet said this. He said, I don't think so and so have any understanding of our religion. I don't think they do. Naam. So the view of the Jamahiru Ahlil Ilm, the majority of the scholars, is that أن الظن الغالب يعمل به مطلقا, that the احتمال, which is راجح, the high assumption, it is implemented unrestrictedly. It is permitted. Naam, مطلقا. But the Zahiriyya, they believe بأن الظن, that the dhan, it is implemented like in one particular place only. في تحقيق مناط المسائل. They only believe that dhan is only used when there is, and inshallah ta'ala, مسائل, تحقيق المناط, تحقيق المناط, تنقيح المناط. We'll take that inshallah ta'ala later. But they say it is only allowed when there is, when we're doing تحقيق المناط. Naam. That's the only time when it's allowed. And for example, they say if witnesses come to witness on a matter, they said this is dhaniyah. The witnesses there, but it's dhan. They could have seen wrong. They could have thought it. It's still, they said that's no problem. But they said it is not. That's called what? That's called تحقيق مناط المسائل. As for adillat al-ahkam al-shar'iyya, the evidences of the Sharia, to use that for what? To use that for dhan, as high assumption, they said no. And based on that, they rejected qiyas, an analogy. They rejected it. Na'am. And other matters like that. ولذلك العلامة محمد الأمين الشنقيطة رحمه الله in Surah Al-A'raf, I advise all of you to go to it, Adwa'u al-Bayan. Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqita rahimahullah, he refutes Ibn Hazm on the issue of Qiyas. Ibn Hazm takes the argument that the Qiyas, the first person who did it was Iblis alayhi la'ayinullah, when he said, خَلَقْتَنِي مِن نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِن طِين. Oh Allah, I'm better than him. And then when he said, oh Allah, I am better than Adam, what was his analogy? My original essence. The reason why I'm better from him, his analogy is what? The reason why I'm better than Adam is because what I was created from is better than what Adam was created from. So Ibn Hazm says, أول من قاس, the first person who ever done analogy is Iblis. So based on that, he refutes analogy, and that analogy shouldn't be used. Ibn Hamd al-Amin al-Shanqiti in his Adwa' al-Bayan, he has a very nice research on that matter. Inshallah, go back to it. So to us, inshallah ta'ala, madhhab al-jumhur aqwa min jihati al-dalil al-sabiq. The jumhur are more stronger based on the ayah that I just gave you in Surah Al-Baqarah and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in which I brought. The author then says in that same line of poetry, he says, فَلَا يُزِيلُ الشَّكُّ لِلْيَقِينِ. Doubt cannot remove a certainty. Doubt cannot come and remove certainty. This is very important. For example, a person, doubt comes to him after there was certainty of a matter, but then doubt comes and he's like, oh, I don't know, I'm doubtful. To us, what do we say? We will say, based on the Sharia, فَإِنَّهُ لَا يُلْتَفَتُ إِلَى الشَّكْ. Don't look at that doubt. No. Stick to what you had already, which is the certainty. And this is very important, that a person understands this. But then, this is important. A person has to have had what? The person had certainty that was present. فَلْيَقِينُ الثَّابِتِ. The certainty which was there, then the doubt is something that came later. We stick with what's already there, which is the certainty, and forget the doubt. So a person says, I have wudu. I know I made wudu. I am certain I had wudu. I am now doubtful whether that wudu is gone. أَنَا فِي شَكٍ. Did I break it? Did I not? We will say to him, now there is certainty there. Which is what? The wudu was there. The doubt that's saying that wudu is gone cannot remove the certainty that's already there. It can't. So we won't look and we won't give no attention towards what? The doubt. We will stick to the certainty that we have and we will stick to it. What's the evidence for this qa'ida? Many texts. From them is قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى سُورَةُ يُونِسْ آيَة 36. Allah says, وَمَا يَتَّبِعْ أَكْثَرُمْ إِلَّا ظَلًّا إِنَّ ظَلَّ لَا يُغْنِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ شَيْئًا. And the statement of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, إِن يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا ظَنَّ وَإِنَّ ظَنَّ لَا يُغْنِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ شَيْئًا. And also, Surah Al-Najm, Ayah 28. And also, the hadith of Abdullah ibn Zayd, which is in Sahih al-Bukhari al-Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَنَّهُ شُكِيَ إِلَى النَّبِي sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, الرَّجُلُ يَجِدُ الشَّيْئَ فِي الصَّلَاةِ. That the messenger, alayhi salatu wa salam, he was told, and a complaint was brought to him, that a man, he finds doubt in his heart when he's in the prayer. He thinks, he's in a state of doubt. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The messenger said, لَا يَنْصَرِفُ. The person is not allowed to exit that prayer, حَتَّى يَجِدِ رِيحًا. Unless he receives a wind. أو يسمع صوتا, or unless he hears a noise. Don't leave it. Meaning, stick with the prayer, because some people have waswas. Na'am. Also the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِذَا شَكَّ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي صَلَاتِي فَلَمْ يَدْرِ أَصَلَّى ثَلَاثًا أَمْ أَرْبَعًا فَلْيَطْرَحِ الشَّكَّ وَلْيَبِنْ عَلَى الْيَقِينِ. The Messenger said, if one of you doubts in his prayer, did he pray three or four? The Prophet said he should toss the doubt and get rid of it, and he should stick with the certainty. This qa'ida, which is al-yaqinu la yazulu bishak, this qa'ida is a qa'idatun muhimma. It's a very powerful principle, very, and it enters a lot of the chapters of the religion or fiqh. A lot of matters pertaining to qawa'id al-fiqhiyyah are connected to this qa'ida. They're connected to this. A lot of matters are. For example, the matters that fall under it are mainly three, inshaAllah ta'ala. They're categorized, the qawa'id that fall under it are categorized into three. The first one is masailu yuttafaqu ala indirajiha fil qa'ida wa yuttafaqu ala hukmiha. Matters and issues that are agreed upon, it falling under this qa'ida. Ulama are unanimously in agreement that this issue falls under this qa'ida, which is اليقين أن يقين لا يزول بالشك. And also its ruling is agreed upon. Also its ruling is also agreed upon. For example, an example for that, the first type is what? A person who is in a state of impurity. And من كان محدثا في الصباح. A person who in the morning he had impurity. ثم شك بعد ذلك. And then after that he has a doubt. هل طرأت الطهارة عليه؟ هل توضأ بعد ذلك؟ He starts to think, I was impure. Did I go out of my way and do wudu? The certainty that's present here is what? It is that he knew he was impure. The doubt here, which is what? That he thinks that he has purity. فَلَا يُلْتَفَتُ إِلَى الطَّهَارَةِ Don't look at the purity. Don't even think about looking at the purity. Why? Because the doubt which was there is that impurity. We'll stick with what was already there. Another example is, a person, أَلْيَقِينَ أَنَّهُ لَا يَجُوزُ وَطْءُ الْأَجْنَبِيَّةِ A person is certain that it is not permissible to have intimacy with a foreign woman. That's not your wife. It's not permissible. Naam. The person has a doubt now. Did the marriage take place between me and this woman? Did this me and this woman? Did we get married? فَالْأَصْلُ أَنَّ الْأَجْنَبِيَّةُ مُحَرَّمَةُ وَلَا يَجُوزُ وَطْءُهَا The asal is that we are sure that the woman who is a ajnabiyya, a foreigner from you, she's haram. You're not even sure if the wedding took place. Or the aqdul nikah. Or you don't know if the aqdul nikah, you and this woman have been married off to each other. You don't know. Ajib. So who would be absent-minded? But it's a qa'idah example. So this that example is, we're certain that it's not permissible to have intimacy with a woman who's a foreigner. We're certain about that. But we're in doubt whether you got married to this woman. And your doubt is full about it. The shak here right now is going to, the certainty is going to be stuck to, which is that it is haram for you to have intimacy with this woman. Now, the second type is masailun matters. Ittafaqa ala indirajiha fil qa'idati wa ikhtulifa fil hukm. The scholars are unanimously in agreement that this issue falls under the qa'ida al-yaqinu la yazulu bishak. But they are disputing whether the ruling is the same. Or they dispute what? The hukum, the ruling, in which is going to be placed in this matter. They dispute one another, the ruling. Example will make it clear for you. For example, a person, إِذَا كَانَ الْإِنسَانُ مُتَطَهِرًا فِي الصَّبَاحِ A person, he is pure in the morning. ثُمَّ شَكَّ He started to doubt. هَلْ أَحْدَثَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ Did he have impurity that fell onto him? Did he pass a wind? Did he break his tahara? He's doubtful. The asal is what? That the one he's sure about is that he was what? He is pure. The yaqeen here is thabit, right? It's strong, it's present. It doesn't remove with that doubt that came after. And that is the view of the majority of the ulama. Like in the Malikiyyah differ here. They said, no. They believe it falls under this qa'idah, but the way they perceived the reality of this issue is different. The Malikiyyah said, al-yaqeenu, the certainty that we're going to look at here is not the individual's action. They said, we're going to look at, and al-yaqeenu anna salata wajibatun. The yaqeen is that the salah is wajib. Fi dhimmatil insani, on the person's neck and shoulder. فَلَا نُزِيلُ هَذَا الْيَقِينِ We can't remove that certainty بِطَهَارَةٍ مَشْكُوكٍ فِيهَا With a tahara which we doubt. Whether he broke it or not. We're doubting it. The salah is only on your neck. We know the salah conditions tahara. You as an individual are what? Are doubtful whether you've got that tahara. So the Malikiyyah said, فَلَا يَجُوزَ أَن يُصَلِّي وَالْحَالُ هَذِي You can't pray. Another example that falls under this one is what? إِذَا طَلَّقَ الْإِنسَانُ زَوْجَتَهُ A man divorces his wife. وَشَكَّ And he doubts. هل طلقها ثلاثة أو واحدة? Whether he divorced her three or one, he does. The majority of the ulama of the view, which is what? النكاح في الزمان الأولي. The nikah at the beginning when you got married to your wife, which was what? And that is certain is that you had three. That you had a full, that your wife was fully yours and there was no talaq. When you got married to her, the day you got married to her, there wasn't talaq. That is mutayaqqan. We know that and that's yaqeen, certainty. We won't remove the doubt that you have brought. فَلَا نُزِيلُ بِالطَّلَاقِ مَشْكُوكٍ فِي. We're not going to remove it with a talaq that is doubted. We're not going to take it. And we will consider it بِأَنَّهَا طَلْقَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. That is only one. We won't take the three, we'll just take one. The Malikiyah, they said, لَا. The certainty is what? تَحْرِيمُ وَطْءُ الْأَجْنَبِيَّةِ. The placing and having intimacy with a woman who is a foreigner from you is haram. So their asal, their yaqeen is not the marriage. Their yaqeen is what? The essence of intimacy with a woman. A woman is as-salalan, she's haram from you. That's the certain. To permit it for yourself, you have to be evidence. If a man says to you, Akhi, this woman is haram from you, are you with me? He's sticking with the asal. You have to be evidence that this is your wife. You have to say, my witness and fulan, and my witnesses. That's when you're allowed. Naam. They said now, فَلَا نُزِيلُ هَذَا الْأَصْلِ الْمُتَيَقِّنِ بِنِكَاحٍ مَشْكُوكٍ. They said, we're not going to remove it with a nikah which is doubtful, and because of that, we're going to count it as thalath talaqat, three talaqat. Your wife is, she's not yours anymore. Then we go back to the yaqeen which we're sure of. We'll stick with that. She's not your wife anymore. You're going to leave her. So here, when you look at it, they all believe it falls under what? They all believe it falls under the qa'ida to the qa'ida, which is al yaqeen la yazulu bil shak. But the issue that they disputed is the hukum. The ruling that comes out of it. Whereas the first part, what was it? They believed that it falls under this qa'idah, but they also agreed on the hukum. The third one, inshaAllah ta'ala, is what? Masailun ay masail. Yadrijuha ba'dul fuqaha. Some of the fuqaha put it under this qa'idah. Al-yaqeenu la yazulu bishak. Some scholars. And other groups, they see what? Adami indirajiha, that it shouldn't be thrown under this qa'idah. For example, it would be a person who done wudu. A person, he done what? He done wudu. Some scholars, they say, put it under this qa'idah. Some say, no, it's not under this qa'idah that you mentioned. So the example would be, for example, a person who does wudu in the morning, and then he ate the meat of a camel. He ate camel meat. The scholars, they said, the majority of the ulama, jumhur, they said, لا يزول يقين الطهارة. The certainty of the tahara will not be removed. With what? The doubt of whether you ate, if the meat you ate was a camel meat or not. The others, what did they say? That this issue, they said what? That this issue is what? It doesn't even fall under this qa'idah, aslan. And they took another path regarding it. Anyways, this qa'idah is very important, that the ulama in which they have placed and they have used, it's a very powerful qa'idah. And it's this qa'idah that the ulama took from it, what is known as istishab. Istishab was taken from this qa'idah, which is always the original essence is the certainty. Istishab means the original essence of something. And istishab is of types. Istishab is of types, and there are five types of istishab. There are? No, there are six types of istishab. There are six types of what? There are six types of istishab. The first type of istishab means استصحاب الإباحة الأصلية. The first is called the استصحاب of the original permissibility, that this thing is originally permitted. For example, somebody will say to you, الأصل في الأفعال أنها مباحة. The أصل of actions is that it's permissible. I can do whatever action I like. you have to prove to me that that action is not permitted. I'm sticking with the istishab. The second law is istishabul bara'ah. The original essence of that you're free from this. You're buried from this. Which is فَالْأَصْلُ أَنَّذِيمَ مِنْ بَرِيئَةٍ. The original essence that the person is an innocent, he's free. There's nothing he can be held account for. If I and me and you go to a court, are you with me? The way that the judge would work is as follows. The qadi won't say to me, who's the innocent person, prove your innocency. Never. It doesn't work like that. Anyone who's accusing me, the one who is accusing has to bring the evidence. Because he's trying to get rid of my original essence, my innocency. And that is the asal. Does that make sense? Number three is istishab nassu shari' hatta yuthbit annahu mansukh. The istishab that this text is a nass, meaning it is something that can be used and it's not abrogated, and that it is a evidence I can apply it. The original essence that I use it. Anyone who says it's abrogated, bring evidence. He can't turn to me and say, Akhi, bring evidence that the delil you're using is not abrogated. That's wrong. The evidence is on him to prove that. So no one can just say that this evidence is abrogated unless he brings a evidence. The asal of the text is what? It is that is a proof I can use it. Now, number four is istishab al-umum hatta yati dalil yukhassisu. The istishab is that the text are general, unless there comes something that specifies it. So when I have an ayah, it's am. Illa ma akhassahu dalil. Unless you bring an evidence. So when I say to you, this is a general. My evidence is what? Don't ask me for evidence. I'm sticking to the asal. My evidence is the asal. You have to prove that it's specific. So for example, if you say to me, this action is specific to the Prophet, I don't have to be evidence for that. You have to bring it that's specific to the Prophet. The asal is whatever in the Qur'an and the Sunnah, we need to implement it, what? All of it. It's general, it's for everybody. If you say this is to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what do I say to you? Bring your evidence for this. Can I marry 9 wives? The asal is yes. If I now, you and I are discussing this issue, I'll say to you yes. You will come to me and say that, it's not. Why? Then you bring evidences. Huh? فَإِنْ طَعَبَ لَكُمْ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ مَثْنَا وَثُلَاثَ وَرُبَعَ. A dalil here, واضح. And this is khas to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Can I just go and marry myself to a woman, just walk into the road and say, sister, you're mine, I married you now. Can I? But I said, I can say to you now, it's permissible. This action, the asal of the action is what? It's permissible. Now you're going to say to me that, إِنْ وَهَبَتْ نَفْسَهَا لِلنَّبِي إِنْ أَرَادَ النَّبِي أَنْ يَسْتَنْكِحَ خَالِصَةً لَكَ مِنْ دُونِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. This is khalis, this is only for the Prophet. So this you specify in the evidences which are general. The fifth one is istishabul wasf. The description is the asal of the description. What do I mean by the asal of this description? The istishab, which is the taharatu thabitati fi sabah, that this description of purity, is the asal is that. The istishab al-taharati thabitati fi sabahi, which is present in the morning. Naam. For example, a person all day he's pure. Unless the Shari'ah, when he came and he said, no, when you wake up you can't be pure, even if you haven't done anything, it doesn't matter, the Shari'ah gave an exception to this. Naam. Number five, which is ijma'. Sorry. Number six is what? Istishab. Halul ijma' fi mahalli niza'. Ijma. What does that mean? For example, the ulama, they unanimously agreed upon أَنَّ مَرَّ الْمَا قَبْلَ الصَّلَاةِ بَطَلَ تَيَمُّمُ. An example for this would be, for example, the scholars, they disputed one another. They what? They disputed one another. Does the purity... Sorry. أَجْمَعَ الْعُلَمَاءِ. The scholars unanimously agreed upon أَنَّ مَرَّ الْمَاءَ. The person who sees water قَبْلَ الصَّلَاةِ, before the prayer, his tayammum is nullified. Before the prayer. ثُمَّ اخْتَلَفُوا. Then the scholars disputed one another. إِذَا رَأَوْهُ فِي أَثْنَاءِ الصَّلَاةِ. If he sees it whilst he's in the prayer. فَتَغَيَّرَتْ إِحْدَى. إحدى الصفات. They said one of the descriptions here has changed. فهل يصح للإنسان أن يقول؟ Is it permissible for a person to say إذا رأى الماء قبل الصلاة بطل تيمم بالإجماع؟ فنستصحب ذلك فيما إذا رآه في أثناء الصلاة. Is it permissible for a person to use istishab here and to say because there is an ijma that we know it's out there that says that if the person he sees water, are you with me? Are you guys there? Can I use the ijma as evidence by saying the istishab of the ijma by saying that the ijma it says that if you see the water before the salah, your tayammum is nullified. So it gives me that I'm going to say that the ijma' permits that if he sees it whilst in the prayer, that it will nullify. I'll bring that ijma', I'll move it whilst the prayer. Saying that if it's with, before the prayer, it will take the ijma' here. This is called ijma'un fi mahallin niza'. To bring ijma' in a place where there's a mahallun niza', there's a discussion in it. Something you have an ijma' for, you say this ijma', it still goes on. And you say to the other person, you bring evidence that it can. And you just stick with the ijma'. Can you say that? Some scholars, they say, na'am. Another group of scholars, they said, wal-mustashabu, the istishab, laysa huwa al-ijma'u, it is not ijma'. Not at all. And it seems like that is the strongest view. Now. Nah.